Dave.
All right, welcome everybody to Teaching Tree. I'm going to let Lisa and Kelly take it away.
Okay, hello and good morning. Thank you all for joining us this Friday. My name is Lisa Victoria Hoffmeyer, and I'm co-host with Kelly Spoon. And we're going to talk to you today about grading transparency. Can you go to the next slide?
This one? Or yes. A different one?
Oh, yeah, sorry. What's that? Sorry, I might've been looking at the first one still. Okay, so we're gonna talk about making grading transparent. And we're hoping to spend about the first half of today's hour with our discussion and presentation, and then the second half actually getting to do some work. So first we wanted to talk about the why, which is in hopes to lessen your workload and student complaints by incorporating equitable grading practices. And then we're also gonna talk about the how, which is to demystify your grading criteria and empower students with rubrics, assignment categories, clear instructions, and class-wide announcements. So whether you're grading mood boards in Fashion or using a tried and true worksheet in Math, we have you covered with some time-saving tips that are student-centered. So let's continue and go to the next slide.
All right, so when talking a little bit about the why, this was actually perfect timing. Yesterday's Teaching in Higher Ed podcast was ungrading. So it was like right on theme with what we're gonna be talking about today. And so the woman actually spent the entire podcast talking about ungrading, which was this idea that as soon as we add grades to something, we take away the intrinsic value of learning for learning's sake. She was like, if somebody told you, her analogy, somebody told you this peach is delicious, please eat this peach, you'd wanna eat the peach. But if someone said, please eat this peach, I'll give you $5. Now you're wondering what the hell's wrong with the peach. And so she's like, as soon as we add point values to things, we sort of take away why we would want to learn them in the first place. So we're not going to get into ungrading, although that is like my end goal very far in the future for when I just can do these things. But we're going to talk about how to grade equitably. And as Lisa said, we are going to be talking mostly about how to grade in a way that lessens our workload and really makes students feel like they understand where their grades are coming from. So for me, I've never had a student ask me to explain why they got a grade on something or complain about their grade at the end of the semester because my grading criteria is very, very clear from the very start. So a little bit of the how, this by the way is I should play Tasha right now. Grading for equity. Oh, wait, Rachel. Yes, thank you. this is from the book, Grading for Equity. And so Joe Feldman, in his book, he gives four ways to do this, to grade equitably. Things that you can adjust. Oh, wait, Katie, you're bringing it out too? Sorry, we'll do it one more time. We should take a screenshot. Katie, you got a screenshot? I don't know if you have the whole, you're all blurred anyways.
No, I'm blurred and not ready for a screenshot.
So grading for mathematical accuracy. And so by the way, as I talk about these hows from Joe Feldman's book, feel free to share your how you do some of these things in the chat. Basically, the mathematical accuracy argument is that as soon as we enter a zero in a student's grade, we're weighting their grade towards failure, right? If failing is 50%, a zero has a huge impact on that. A zero and 100, they average to a 50%. So there's a lot of ways around that, whether it's dropping low grades or giving 50s instead of zeros, but we're not gonna talk about that today. Some other ways you can make sure that your grading is equitable, make sure you're valuing knowledge and not compliance. I hear from a lot of my colleagues in my department that if students don't submit things as a single PDF and in a certain format that they get zero, and that's grading compliance. Valuing growth within your grading process. And then as Lisa said, today we're gonna be talking about lifting the veil, really making the grading process transparent for everybody. So here are some ways that we can lift the veil and we'll give examples from our classes. We aren't gonna get into syllabus language because at this point it's a little too late for anybody to change up their syllabus. So if you wanted an example, I threw a section from my syllabus on there in terms of how I make clear how I'm gonna be grading my class, but we are going to get into the rest of these things. So grading categories, I use emojis like crazy. I blame Katie. She showed us in Build with Buddies that we could add emojis to our assignments. And so I've started doing that. And then I added a grading legend so that students knew if something has this little teacher symbol next to it, you should do it before you attempt a knowledge check. It's never going to close. It's not worth anything. And here's how you should be doing it. Same thing with the knowledge checks. Those you should do by the due date, they close on a certain time, and then some other hints about it. So in terms of adding those emojis, super straightforward. If you already have existing modules, and yes, we will share the slides. I just go in and click edit. And then if you press the Windows key and period at the same time, if you're on a PC, you can add emojis to anything. So this seems like it should be a hand wave. Sorry, Katie, I'm adding things to your course. You'll have to deal with it. This is the teaching tree. So then you can just go in and categorize all of your grades really quickly by just pressing edit and then adding emojis to each thing. So that's one of the ways that I kind of make it very clear what counts for a grade, what doesn't, and lessen emails from students who are asking, well, what about I haven't turned this in yet? You're muted. You're muted.
Okay. So for the next slide, we're talking about clear instructions. And so I put some bullet points in there and I just wanted to read through them pretty quickly. So how to make your instructions clear is to keep it direct and simple, provide additional resources or references, have a peer review for clarity, which is something that Kelly had mentioned to me and I thought that was a great one to add. Poll students for feedback and then you can update your instructions accordingly. Keep formatting and layout consistent throughout your entire course. Encourage students to ask questions. And also don't overwhelm them with too much information. So I'm sure we've all had examples of that where an assignment is just going on and students are having to scroll down. I feel like you're really setting them up for failure when you're doing that. So really clear, concise, and to the point. So next slide, please. So I just popped this in here. This is just an example of an assignment from one of my courses, Fashion 173, which is marketing on the internet. So I'm not going to read all of that, but I did put an image in there. It's tiny. In my regular instructions, it's full size and it's at the top. So it really gives a great visual representation of what students should be striving for in completing this particular assignment. And then I also broke it down by kind of like little subcategories, and you could put them in as headers. So I have like details, preferred formatting, some notes and tips. I've got an article link there for reference. And then at the bottom in my instructions, there are some more examples for inspiration, reference, and just representation to really give students an example. I think the visuals really help, and they've explained that you know, solidifies exactly what I'm asking for in my instructions. Okay, next slide.
I love this. Wait, I'm gonna interrupt you. So do you keep the same format, like details, format, notes, tips, like for all of your assignments?
Yes.
I like it. All right, so yes, clear instructions, super useful. I have many instructions on discussion boards I have tried that I literally edit every semester. Like I make notes as to what students are kind of misunderstanding in my instructions, and then I go back the next semester and hope that I make that better, and sometimes I make it worse, but it's a constant editing cycle. So I also am obsessed with rubrics. I have gotten many of my math colleagues on board. I've gotten text messages to say, why didn't I use rubrics earlier? Rubrics are equitable in the sense that they share information and power. They let students know exactly what the points are based on. There's nothing subjective that they can point to and say, well, she just doesn't like me. That's why she gave me, you know, a 3 out of 5 on this particular component. So they provide clarity and transparency. There's so great in terms of actual workflow. Also, if you're somebody who's like grading takes any amount of my time and it's a pain in the butt, it makes life so much easier. So this is just a very sad rubric. It's not like an exciting or equitable rubric at all. This is a rubric from one of my worksheets that is a holdover from when I taught in person. So you can see number one, they either got full points. And then the nice thing here is a lot of the feedback that I was typically writing to students, like, oh, you forgot units on number one, I just click a button and now they know that they were missing units on number one and I don't have to have any typing, any work there. So in terms of grading on a rubric, the other reason I love grading on a rubric is that, it's decent Zoom, is that if students submit things in multiple pages or multiple uploads or out of order, it doesn't matter, I can keep track of where everything is. So my colleagues who need everything in a PDF in a certain format, students will upload things in the wrong order and it's fine. I can open up whatever they're doing. I can rotate it. in the speed grader, and I can start at number three, even if it's not at number, that's where my rubric starts. I can say, oh, that was good. This is good. And I can just give my feedback that way. And I'm very, very lazy. I even have Sim Barhum got me into this. I have a text replacement tool where I have a quick little like, hey, I added some comments to the rubric. Perhaps you want to go look at that so that I don't have to do any typing at all while I'm grading. That is my goal. So back to Lisa.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Can you go back to the rubric that you just
Yes.
So you said, because I haven't used this tool yet in Canvas. So you, at the bottom, when you said the comments, mm-hmm. So did you type something extra in the rubric or?
So you can do it either way. So in this rubric, let me look at the students. I think this wasn't perfect, if I recall, this example I grabbed. Maybe it was. Oh, she did. She did a perfect job. I'm so sorry. But if she had a mistake and there was something that I didn't have a note here, like, oh, you made a mistake, but it's not here. Uh-huh. I can use the little comment button to actually put a comment on the part that they have that mistake on.
All right. Okay.
And so some of mine, I have pre-built little statements for certain sections of rubrics based on what I know they will screw up or what needs a little bit more feedback. But this is the general submission comment. And then when you save it, it tells you exactly where all their points were. They can see it.
Love it.
Yeah, no. So it's awesome in terms of being able to keep track of points for you. Cause that I used to be like -1, scroll. Okay. That's -2. Like I was constantly trying to keep track of all these points in my brain and it was a pain to do. So I love my rubrics. Everything has a rubric.
Kelly, can I ask a question?
Yes, Megan.
Can you do the opposite where you add points to an area? Cause I have a lot of times where student and where I didn't like rubrics in the past is it wasn't flexible enough for me where they would do really well in one area and almost overdo an area and then underdo an area. And could you give them,
I can give them five, I can give them 3 points
on
here.
Something. Okay. Yes. And then explain why they got more points mm-hmm. in that area. Cause it helps kind of shore some things up.
In fact, Megan, there's, this is recent. You can have your rubric have more points in it than the actual assignment is worth. So if you're somebody who likes extra credit for something, you can actually have, your rubric be scored out of 18 and have an exceptional and have the assignment be worth 15, right? So okay, then you could do exactly what you're saying.
And the students, so your students see, they can click on this whole rubric and they can see.
Yeah, when they go to the actual-
Before they do the assignment?
When they go to the assignment, this is what the assignment looks to them. They can see, here's the worksheet, my lame old worksheet.
Yeah.
Here is the rubric right below it. So theoretically, they should not be making any of these mistakes because they can see this right when they go to the assignment. They know people are often missing the total rows and columns or they're missing, units on something. And so they shouldn't be making those mistakes, hopefully. They do, but hopefully they shouldn't be.
Okay, so next we'll look at providing past examples. So I'll just read these really quickly. Students love a point of reference, providing past or real world examples to ensure students understand what is expected and inspires them to greatness. Asking students to share their assignment makes them very proud of their work and it goes hand in hand as part of clear instructions. So students often request assignment examples when they're not provided. And I have found that when I supply these examples, students will thrive more and the quality of work is elevated. So I can often share multiple examples and inform students their assignments don't have to look exactly like the ones that I provide, but that they should use them for inspiration. And for visual assignments is especially important as it provides a guide for students to work from. And it also can exemplify what is stated in the rubric. For example, here's what your assignment should include, see sample, and then reference for grading purposes. Okay, next slide.
Nice. All right, so we're gonna plant a couple of more seeds. These are more along the valuing knowledge, not compliance, and the valuing growth, as opposed to lifting the veil in terms of the grading practices. So first I wanted to share this. This is a rubric that a colleague shared in my department for grading a written work and a presentation on a problem. So you can see there's explanation, solution. So these are related to math. You can see they use the appropriate strategies and skills learned in class. But then eventually it gets down to eye contact, volume, preparedness. And so I just want to point out that valuing knowledge, I really think it's important to stick within what is actually within our content Instead of grading students on things that might be cultural or might be outside the purview of what we're actually talking about, sticking to the math of a problem. And I actually like Lisa's thing, having like multiple ways to submit or make that assignment that she had. You know, you can use PowerPoint, you can use Adobe Spark, you can use whatever you want, sort of giving them other ways into it. So in terms of these lifting the veil, like not lifting the veil, but the grading for value and grading for growth, I see these as forming learning partnerships, right? And so there's three things we're going to chat about and show our examples for. Resubmissions. Lisa's already talked a little bit about highlighting student work, but she's going to show some examples, and then using those submission comments and feedback, which will be a preview of Rachel's teaching tree, why and how, in like week 10. I know you can't even remember you signed up for that.
It's like, so, not anytime soon.
No, it's just really far away. So resubmissions, I allow my students to resubmit everything in my course. I know Tasha does the same in her standards-based grading class because it's about learning, right? The points are not for points. In fact, if you give feedback to a student, most of the time, they're not going to read that if it's with a summative grade, right? If there's nothing that they can gain. Yes, Megan.
So as I get excited because this is something I want to work towards, but I just, my issue, I think where my stumbling point is like workload for me. And I understand that that's, you know, yeah, workload for me. And then also teaching people to be able to meet deadlines.
So I'm
just curious if there's that you could help me kind of.
I can definitely help you with the first one. The second one, it does take a while. Like there's always that pushback of like, well, in a real job, like what if you didn't make a deadline? I mean, you wouldn't be fired the first time you didn't make a deadline, right? You would probably explain why you didn't make the deadline and you'd be able to do it a little bit late. So, I mean, part of that comes to me that like the grading value of what they're learning versus like, am I grading compliance? And so it took me a long time to be like, okay, I need to stop grading for compliance. It's me wanting it turned in by a certain date. I get it. Like it doesn't need to happen at that date. But the first one was a bigger stumbling block for me. Like if I let students turn things in willy-nilly whenever they want, my life is going to be chaotic. It's way easier to grade 100 things that are all the same at once than it is to grade like 5 and then 4 and then turn my brain on to that. So I'll show you how easy a resubmission is when you're using a rubric. So here's a student's work. The student has approved that I show it. I asked her, I was like, can I show your work? You can actually see Megan here. She has submitted this now 5 times. But the nice thing is with the rubric, I mean, this, I look at the rubric, I know exactly what she missed. When I'm regrading it, I know I just need to look at number 4 and I know what her mistake was on number 4. So in terms of regrading this, I'm just gonna scroll right to her number 4, see that it is now the right value, change it right there. And then I'm gonna look, okay, number 6 was also wrong, it's now good. Number 7 was wrong, it's now good. I can save this. She now, oops. Oh, it's because I went to the student view. I do not know why it's mad at me. But theoretically, I should be able to press save. And now she has a 20 out of 20. So it does take a slight amount of work, but I'd say I probably spend 15 minutes each day regrading resubmissions. That's my first thing when I wake up is, let's grade those submissions as they come in. And with a rubric, it's not hard to do the switch from like one thing to another. And I do think it's valuable because otherwise I give all this feedback and it doesn't go anywhere. No one's learning from it. They're just like, great, I got a 15 out of 20. I guess I'll take it. In fact, one of the places I'd like to go eventually is instead of giving them 15 out of 20, giving them an incomplete until it's perfect, because then they really have to do it. Because now some of them will decide 15 out of 20 is good enough and I don't knock
them. Okay, gotcha. Thank you, Kelly.
So that was the resubmissions. That's the thing I get the most positive feedback on. I ask them for feedback in mid-semester and at the end of the semester. And the most often thing people say they really value was the ability to revise and resubmit. It also keeps me from having a lot of stuff. Those worksheets, some students will still go to Chegg and write down just the answers that they found online, but it's much less likely because there's really not an incentive to just do it for the points. So I'll move back to Lisa.
Okay, we got 5 minutes. We can do this. So highlighting student work via weekly announcements. So I love weekly announcements. I send them out every week in every class that I teach. And this is just something that I wanted to mention that you could potentially do in your courses if you aren't already. So I like to share out a few highlights, kind of best ofs, and include grading feedback and stats. For example, you could talk about that these are the best boards that you've seen if they're doing mood boards, or that, you know, the kind of class average was a B plus on this particular assignment that you were grading for that week. Students really like seeing their classmates' boards in this particular project. So I shared a few of them in a weekly announcement after the project was turned in. And I received a lot of responses to that weekly announcements where students were kind of sharing feedback and continuing the conversation within the announcement comments. And it was very positive and supportive engagement. So this is just a quick example that I popped in there. I shared two different boards that were done. And I wrote, I want to share that I have really enjoyed reviewing your customer profiles and trend boards. You all did an excellent job showcasing creativity, skills, and knowledge in identifying your target markets and trend forecasts with strong visual representation. Great work in completing these assignments. I love them all. And I wanted to highlight a few for each of you to review. Please reply in the announcement and share your thoughts with the class. And like I said, I got a really good response from these when I post them. So it's things that I try and kind of sprinkle out throughout my courses just for a point of reference. Okay, next slide.
I did.
Okay. So this one, highlighting student work, you can ask good questions, unique solutions and or connections that were made, and common misconceptions and errors. So this could also be something where I think Kelly touched on a little bit earlier today. If there were, you know, some similar mistakes that were made, or you were seeing things come through and students were misunderstanding instructions, this would be a way to discuss it more openly in the weekly announcements instead of individually making those comments on student work.
And it's very nice if you allow resubmissions, if you have instructions that you thought were clear and maybe weren't so clear, you don't have to worry as much about it because you have your butt covered in terms of, oh, okay, actually you guys kind of missed the boat a little bit. But I really do like highlighting student questions. In fact, most of my weekly quizzes, the very last question is, did you have any questions about this week's material? And so I'll bring in those favorite questions that people have made and say, here they are. They were awesome. So yes, go here's the feedback I gave that student so that everybody gets the benefit of that. And I really want students to start recognizing how to ask a good question in a class. So that's part of the reason why I do that. And then sometimes I'll just lie and I'll bring questions from previous semesters because nobody's asking me anything. And I want them to feel like they're supposed to be asking me something. So I'll just be like, lots of you have asked this question. And then they feel like it's less weird to reach out to the instructor and ask questions. And then this was just another one that I put in. This was a student who had done a really good job. She went through all of my practice material and wrote down questions that when she didn't understand stuff. And so I was like, you guys need to check. I asked for her permission. Like, can I share this with the class? I need to show everybody what it looks like to study this material in the correct way. And so sort of doing a little bit of metacognition, like how are we supposed to be doing this learning along the way. So that's what I highlight in announcements.
Perfect. Next slide.
We're there.
Okay. Okay. So for the submission comments and feedback, I love giving feedback, and I have found that providing audio and video lands best with students, and they repeatedly tell me it's their preferred method of receiving feedback over written. They also reply in the comment sections of the assignments using audio and video more often when I've provided that initially. This increases their communication throughout the course and improves work significantly. Sometimes time just doesn't allow for all that audio and video feedback. So I do have a document with kind of general comments and feedback that I can copy and paste into the assignment section if I want to. And that can be a huge time saver, but still support student learning because you're still giving them feedback on their assignments. I also wanted to note separately than just adding comments into individual assignments that are going out to specific students, you can just use the announcements for your general feedback. And that could be something that you send out weekly or as you see fit. For example, if like multiple students were struggling with assignment and had the same questions, you could just share that out in an announcement so everybody gets that information. You're not individually typing that into the comments section. So any questions about providing feedback through audio and video? Is anybody else doing that in their courses? Hopefully.
Where are you, how are you doing the video feedback? Like what program are you using?
So I'll Wait, Lisa, do you do this? Do you just click on the thing at the bottom? By the way, this is yes. all of the feedback that this student of I had back and forth about her mistakes. But yeah, at the bottom.
Oh. So you can have it audio dictate, you can do audio only, or you can do video. And there's no downloading. They can inline, they can see it in their Canvas, they can check it on their phones, you can do it on your phone, on the app. It's just really user-friendly and very quick and easy to do.
I love it. Thank you.
Yeah. The one downside I found of it is it doesn't do a screen. Like, so I usually want to like talk about their actual work and like point at things on the screen. And it's a webcam of my face. And I'm like, you don't need to see my face.
Oh, gotcha.
But I mean, students like it.
They do like to see your face, Kelly.
So the only thing I was going to add to that is that, like, again, I have 250 students. I give them 1 to 4 assignments each week. Like, I have so much stuff that I'm giving them feedback on that, like, the individual feedback is overwhelming. I do try to do it at the beginning of the semester for the first 2 weeks. I kill myself to make sure I've built these connections with students, giving them feedback that way. But after that, I really rely on the rubric and a lot of text replacements where I just tell them to go check the rubric, or I have little things that'll pause so I can write in their name and act like it's personalized before it finishes the rest of the sentence. So there are some easy ways to do that. And then I think, yes, here's the sales pitch for Rachel, who didn't remember she is doing this because it's so far in the future. Rachel and Espen.
Didn't want you to sell it as it was happening next week.
It's not. It's happening week 10. So you've got quite a bit of time before you get to hang out with Rachel and Espen to talk about feedback. But we couldn't talk about grading and not talk about feedback. So we had to throw in a little bit of theirs. So we were perfect, by the way. Pat on the back. That was 30 minutes. That just worked out well. Our goal now is to give you guys time to actually put some of this into practice. And so we were going to do breakout rooms. And let me see. What the heck just happened? Allow them to choose a room. Cool. And I need to add one. So I'm going to add 4 rooms. So if you want to play with rubrics and you want some help with rubrics, I'll be happy to help you in room 1, which I'm just going to name rubrics. I'm going to make Katie help people with emojis if for some reason that's what they wanted to do. Sorry, Katie, I'm volunteering you for things. And then
thank you for giving me the easy one.
Lisa's going to work on instructions in case you want to check on your, or were you going to do announcements? I think you're going to do announcements.
I think both.
Okay. So if you want to work on an announcement or instructions, you can go hang out with Lisa in room 3, and then I'll just make a water cooler. I just want to hang out with my friends room as well, because I don't judge anybody.
Is this a good time to stop the recording?
Yes, thank you.